Good evening. I'd like to call the Village Board Committee of the Whole for June 19th, 2023 to order and ask Clerk Rao to please call the roll.
Mayor Pisak.
Here.
Trustee Duffy is absent. Trustee Greco.
Here.
Trustee Lesniak.
Here.
Trustee Mullen.
Here.
Trustee Olson.
Still here.
Trustee Sima.
Here.
Is there anyone present here tonight to provide public comment on non-agenda items? If so, please feel free to come on down to the podium. I see no one in the boardroom. We'll start with our regular agenda. First item is a municipal electric aggregation program. Would Village Manager Ertmode please introduce this item?
Yes, thank you, Mayor. The Village's electric aggregation program was created to provide a lower cost electric supply for residents and small businesses. The program was established following the successful passage of a voter referendum back in March of 2012. Again, this is an optional program that afforded participants the opportunity to opt out of the program as well if they chose to. Electric aggregation, just a quick overview, is a program by which a municipality can aggregate the electric load of its residents who have not individually selected their own supplier and negotiated lower pricing, increased green energy, and the terms that are more protective and favorable for the ratepayer. Fast forward till now, in the past couple years, though, the electric supply market has tightened and no longer can provide significant cost savings to participants as we had in the past. Under these programs, residents and small businesses are guaranteed never to pay more than the current ComEd rate at any given time. Last time the Village had a program was in July of 2020. Again, the rates, ComEd rates, became that much more competitive and the aggregation supplier couldn't beat those rates. So we returned everyone back to the ComEd rate and discontinued our aggregation program for a while and periodically check back in on prices and programs to see if there's any advantages to restarting the program and timing for that. So again, this necessitates some expertise in this field of aggregation, and we're fortunate to have NYMEC as our consultant for our aggregation program. Adam Hoover of NYMEC is here this evening to provide the board a quick overview of the options that are in front of us for a restart of the program and be able to answer any questions the board may have. So Mayor, with that, I'd like to turn it over to Mr. Hoover.
Good evening. Thank you. Appreciate that. The only thing I add, you covered most of it, is that the program that we kind of are presenting right now to you and a lot of other municipalities around is what we call the price match program. It guarantees the same rate for residents. There is no, you know, if the common rate moves a touch month to month, which it may, the residents would see that as well, even if they're with our other supplier, MC Squared. In turn, your options here are a $20,000 civic payment to the Village with kind of, we'll say, no strings attached. It doesn't have to go to green energy. It can go to the general budget and go wherever. Or there's a 5% green option available. The staff is recommending the $20,000 civic payment, and I will let them get to that if they have questions about that. But it's just a good program, and the ComEd rate came out in May. We could not beat it. We're closer than we've been in a couple years. We really think, we've said this the Village Manager a couple of times now, we really think we'll be able to beat it next year. So that's why we personally are recommending a one-year program, so that next year at this time, we can look and see if we can beat the ComEd rate. And if we can find resident savings, that's kind of the number one goal of the program, then we can move forward with that. And if not, then we can hopefully renew the same program we have now. Renewing a program is much easier than kind of restarting an entire program. So that's kind of our suggestion, what we're doing with many towns.
Thank you. With that, I'd like to ask if there's any public comment in the room regarding this agenda item. I see none. So I'd like to start board members' questions and comments to my right with Trustee Sima.
Thank you. My first question is primarily the 5% green energy versus the $20,000. Can you explain why you're advocating for the $20,000 instead of the green energy option?
Just given the limited amount of green energy, they're only 5%. We were from a 100% green energy program at one point. I think the frankly the Village can do more with that $20,000 than the 5%. So that's why we're recommending at this point. If there's a board desire to allocate that 20% to something in particular, staff has been applying for ComEd energy efficiency grants that do sometimes require matching funds, so they could be put towards that, or, you know, rather than allocated that $20,000 as something comes up or go into the general fund as well. Just the 5% just really is enough to move the needle, and I think the village can probably do better with that $20,000 than the 5% green.
And then there would be the possibility of using that $20,000 towards some sort of green energy initiative on their own.
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
Trustee Lesniak?
Same comments that Trustee Sima had, so I'm good.
Trustee Greco?
No comments at this time, thank you.
Trustee Mullen?
Two questions. In the write-up, it says throughout the duration of the program, a small portion of households may be automatically switched between MC2 or MC squared and ComEd electric supply.
Yep.
How, I understand based on the write-up that we would be notifying them, everything would be handled,
yep.
But like what goes into that automatic switching? I'm just kind of curious to understand what that process.
Are you talking about the initial, like, you know, let's say they add 1,000 residents, that initial first time they send out letters, or do you want to know about the entire process in general?
It says, you know, it, throughout the duration.
Yeah, so that's a good question. And so this is, so they have, so they will, I don't want to jump too in the weeds to kind of explain the whole program, but they are not going to add every single resident. That's, I don't want to bore you, but that's how the suppliers will make money and profit on this from their end. They don't need to add everyone. So they'll add bits and pieces. They will, if it's a one-year deal, I doubt this happens, but they would have the right, according to the agreement, to then add maybe in December, if this program started in October. In December, they could add more residents. That would be the same process where they would get a letter from the supplier, and then they would get a letter from ComEd just informing them. As a reminder, they can opt in and opt out of that program at any point. So if they're like, I do not want to be out of this program, they can, you know, say no, and that will take place. But the ultimate reminder is in this program, they'd be paying the same ComEd rate. Once most people find out they're paying the same ComEd rate, they don't yeah. have much of a preference.
Okay. And then, so I've, in my own business, I've been approached by everyone and
yep.
their brother to save me money on
yep.
my electricity.
Yep.
So, I mean, I do have proposals, and I've actually gone with an alternative supplier.
Yeah.
Is that because businesses are using more and it's more advantageous that it's harder, like, for this kind of aggregation program to get a benefit right now, where, like, I know, like, I've got a pretty good benefit from having that alternate supplier?
Yeah, you're asking me a tough question.
I'm sorry.
You're asking me an opinionated question, so I'm trying to. And I'm also in that business, to be full. You know, we help with the streetlights of the village, so we are also in that same sort of business. I live in Chicago. I personally am on ComEd because I cannot find a better rate than ComEd right now.
Mm.
So I personally do not recommend moving to other places, and I'm the example of it. Community solar is kind of the best program out there for savings, and that's another conversation for another day. They likely, I can't explain suppliers' different strategies. Either I'll just say this, I would be wary of a lot of those strategies.
Okay.
Cannot beat the ComEd rate, and what they do is they'll sign you up for 6 months, and then after 6 months, that price just skyrockets.
Gotcha.
We've seen a lot of people who, a friend's grandmother of mine had rates that were 3 times as much as she should have been paying. So we see that often. That is,
okay.
I can't.
So it's not necessarily a realistic assumption that those rates are out there. It may just be like kind of a little bit of gaming.
Correct.
And
maybe there's a supplier I don't know about that has a great rate. I just don't want to say full.
Yeah.
But my personal experience, I'm on ComEd is what I'll say, and I study it every day.
Okay. That helps a lot, because I didn't know if it was like just industry specific
yep.
or different types of.
Yeah, it's all about your load factors, what they call it, but a lot of our buildings and offices and I think things, your homes, do
yeah.
not have great load factors. So.
Okay. That's all I have. Thank
mm-hmm.
you.
I'm sorry, Trustee Olson.
Nothing for me. Thank you.
I have a couple questions. Does staff or yourself know what ComEd's renewable percentage is?
Renewable percentage?
Yeah. I think ComEd.
Yep. So we are all, no matter if you're part of this program or not, so I want to be clear, if you live with a 5%, it would actually be 22%, because by law we're all purchasing, or by taxes, we're all purchasing 17% green energy. That is by ComEd. We cannot change that. So if you're part of this program or not, everyone in Illinois is purchased, or in ComEd territories, at 17%.
So you're adding an additional 5% onto
yep.
the 17,
yep. Yep.
or contributing $20,000 to the
Correct.
the municipality in lieu of adding that additional.
Correct.
But it won't be any lower than ComEd's renewable rate of 17%?
No, we can't, yeah. Even if we wanted to, we couldn't do that.
Okay. Quite honestly, like you've said yourself, after a number of years of switching back and forth, I've stayed on ComEd. I've gotten more questions, more comments, more criticism of the aggregation program, just because the public is not familiar enough with it, and there is no savings to be had. I think if the board chooses the $20,000 differential in lieu of the 5% increase, I don't know what value the 5% increase justifies to the public. If you get questions from the public of billing and services and things like that, but I think if we take the $20,000 alternative for this program, I think we have to strictly define what that $20,000 is to be used for, whether it is further green initiatives, whether it's to pay down property taxes, something deliverable to the taxpayer that they see what they're getting, not just going into the general fund and being buried in some other spending. But that said, when I look at everything in this program and the benefits received, I think it's easier to say to a taxpayer, we couldn't find you a better rate than ComEd, and we couldn't really guarantee you much more. We've done this in the past where we took like a 50% addition to the contribution for those electricity users who wanted that option of paying the same price but getting like a 50% increase in renewable production. And that was the differentiator. But for this to drop to a 5% differential and no savings to anybody, I find it hard to justify the fact that to explain to people when they question why we chose to open this up, it just leads to more confusion. That's my comment. Do you want to go around again once more? We have, I don't know that we got defined direction to staff, but I see some concurrence, when I'm assuming concurrence, but I'll go back to Trustee Simon and go around once again.
No, I agree with what you said. I mean, I have solar panels on my roof, so I have ComEd for the little bit that I do play. But, I'm not sure I see a benefit if we're, other than free $20,000 for our coffers, for the same, there's no change to our residents, really, no benefit to our residents. I'm agreeing with your comments.
Trustee Lesniak?
Ditto what she says.
Okay, Trustee Greco?
I'm just going to add that ComEd, and I know you're not representing ComEd, they're kind of late to the game in terms of renewables as compared to other utilities and other service providers in Illinois and the surrounding area. I'm not particularly a fan of their franchise agreements. They're 99 years, and they're, basically there's non-compete. And if, you do have solar panels or you do have something like that,
yep.
You're offsetting your cost to what you're doing for 16 cents a kilowatt hour, but ComEd's only going to buy it back for 2 cents. And whatever strain is on your system, you're paying for that as well. So my question to you is that in regards to that 17% that you indicated that ComEd is across the board, and I realize you're not ComEd, is that 17%, does that include renewables that might be on residential and commercial homes, or is that strictly renewable from a wind farm or from a solar farm?
I don't quote me on this, but I would say it's the second one. I think that it's their own. It is not including what other people are doing. I do know with, like, there's this new community solar program, like I've talked about, that their goal is to be 100% green by 2045. And so this is all, ComEd wants aggregation to be going because they think that this is way we can get green energy. Like we said, here's 5% green energy, at no cost. But they do not include the residents in what they're doing.
Yeah, I know heat pumps have been in favor and use downstate a lot. You hardly ever hear about it up here in the Chicagoland area. Anytime you're doing new construction, I think that's a consideration, because it literally starts at the ground level.
It's not EPA certified. That's what they would,
is that
some
the problem?
People would say.
Yeah.
That's, so, we had a supplier, I don't need to bore you, but we had a supplier that would say, we will offer you heat recs instead of, and they would give us 20% recs instead of the 5% because it's not, because it's cheaper, but renewable.
My only question is, now that we've kind of gone around on this again, is I've gotten a knock at the door, and it's somebody that does not have a permit to knock, to say, hey, we're looking to do this with your utility. Do they still need to go, and this may be the question for Manager Ertmode, do they still need to obtain a permit and able to inquire about electric suppliers?
And there should be a solicitation permit. If someone's going door to door, there should be a solicitation permit that they've secured from the village. And door to door, we always let residents know to be wary of that. ComEd or the village's aggregation program will never come to your door, ask for personal information, yep, things like that. So we, you know, when we hear about that, and whether the village is called or the police department, however that works, we always make sure we refresh our warning to be wary of things like that, and let people know door-to-door solicitation of energy suppliers is not part of the aggregation program, but it does add to the confusion. So I understand. So if people do encounter that, I'd ask to, you know, encourage people to take a look at their solicitation permit as it's been issued by the village, and also to be wary of those kind of door-to-door energy supply folks. So
I appreciate your public service announcement on that, because it was just 3 months ago somebody knocked on my door and they demanded to see my ComEd bill. They wanted to see my account number and show me how much I could save.
Yep.
And I sent them packing, and then I called the police. So yeah, that's you know, that's an unfair business practice that has kind of arisen out of this. So anyway, I'll leave it with that, and again, I would be in favor of the later when it comes to the civic contribution. Thank you.
I'm sorry, you'd be in favor of which?
The civic contribution,
So joining it with the contribution in funds to the village.
Correct. With a known
purpose.
A known purpose attached to it. Thank you.
Okay. Trustee Mullen.
So one question, Village Manager Mode. When we were part of the program and things would switch, did we get a lot of calls of people who were kind of struggling with, did it impact staff time?
I don't want to say there's no staff time involved, but if there is a question, usually we will refer them to NYMEC, and NYMEC provides us with a callback number, and we really refer residents to NYMEC, and they've been very responsive to have conversations with those residents there, the experts. So I wouldn't say we get, you know, people are used to this program a little bit, so the calls have diminished a bit, but we still will get a call, and people want to verify because the mailings that go out have the village logo. We have to provide all those things, so we do get some calls.
Okay. So I do think it's interesting, having heard what everyone said, hadn't, you know, that there is, I get it, that there is some tendency for confusion of like, why is this switching? What is going on? The first time I got my letter, I was just like, oh, you know, shortly after we moved here. So I understand that, but I do really like the idea of joining the program, based on what was said also, that it's easier to renew for in it. If things trend down and become more beneficial, it's easier to stay in and renew the program rather than opt in for the first time. I do like the idea, though, if we were to do it, that using the $20,000 towards an energy efficiency grant or match or program, something that would see a reduction in energy cost for the village, and putting it towards that. So that's where my brain is.
And that completes your questions?
That completes my comments.
Thank you. Trustee Olson?
I guess my only question is, to piggyback off of what was said, is if we're to move forward, then for formal adoption at the next meeting, I guess, will staff have a specific energy efficient idea of how to apply the $20,000?
If part of, if that's board direction, we'll find a purpose.
Okay, and then if not, I guess what would be, sorry to put you on the spot, but what would be alternative ideas, you know, of uses to I guess the mayor's point of something that is readily identifiable as a benefit to taxpayers? Are there 10 potential items?
Some of the you know, ComEd efficiency programs and the grants, they do require matching. So it's, you know, if it's EV charging stations or whatever, it's 10 grand. If it's, I know they do the Powering the Holidays, where we would apply for a grant and they would provide some of the costs towards lighting and things like that we do for the holiday season. But those are all dependent on us receiving the ComEd Energy Efficiency Grant Program, being awarded one of those grant programs. So, you know, I think staff would have to huddle and come up with a recommendation between now and the next meeting and bring that back if there's enough board consensus to move it forward. The other option is if there is kind of concern with moving forward and that, you know, the savings or the amount, the green energy isn't there. Adam, perhaps you could elaborate if we did decide to take a pause for these next 12 months, you anticipate ComEd, we may be able to beat ComEd's prices. At what point can we bring this conversation back to the board should the board decide not to move forward with what's on their plate right now?
You could renew this program in December, in whatever month you get. There's no legal binding restrictions on when to restart. The reason we've kind of come to a lot of our municipalities is we said May was when we found out, okay, we can't beat the rates in May, and so now we're kind of presenting everyone. Now we think we can get you on a timeline where, the way I look at it, I would just say that is that's just $20,000 here to run a program that we think we can kind of get on the cycle. So the sooner we get started, I think the closer we can get to that cycle. But if you did want to pause, we could come back. We would come back in, you know, May, and we would start the conversation over again.
Or whenever the rates were favorable, yes. If they were favorable.
Yes. We don't think we'll see much of a change from now till May. We think we're kind of set at we cannot be ComEd, and we don't think the market has really dropped, and so we think we flattened out. We think this is kind of the best offer you'll have, and if you want to pause, we probably wouldn't, unless something crazy happened, we probably wouldn't reach out again till spring of next year.
Okay. So.
The only question I have to ask is, any of these mailings that go out to customers, does the postage affect the village, or are they sent completely at the expense of others?
No cost in any part of this program to you. It's on this is the kicker. It is on Lisle letterhead, but that is paid by MC Squared in this example. Everything is paid for them by them. So there's no cost. Like we said, the only real cost is the calls that come in, and we will gladly take all of them, any of them, and help out in any way we can.
Okay. I think we've heard everything and asked all the questions there are to ask. My quick tally shows 2-4 and 2 against. I don't know if I've got that. Or actually, well, 2-4, 2 against, and I don't have it recorded. Trustee Greco was for it. So 3-3 for it, but then defining a purpose. Do we have consensus with moving forward, pending, provided that we can find a purpose, or does anybody want to reconsider any thoughts? I'm going to remain neutral in this, so I'm in the nuclear industry, so I just don't want any conflict.
Not quite sure how to answer, but I agree that I think I heard three of us are in favor and would like that benefit to go towards something beneficial to our taxpayers and related to energy.
I'm in favor of that too.
Okay, so then we have consensus then.
Yes, I would agree with that as well.
Staff concur.
Okay, we're Rego will bring this agreement back with a resolution attached, and we will, in the meantime, we will identify a green initiative program to put the 20K towards and bring that back in July.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is the National Community Survey, information regarding a proposed community survey tool, the NCS by Polco. Village Manager Ertmod, would you please introduce staff's presentation?
Yes, I will be kicking it to Matt Havlak in just a quick second. But again, the strategic plan that the board approved for 2022-2025 includes a number of performance areas for, to be specific, all with outcome metrics. A number of those outcome metrics are tied to the results of a community survey. So Village Manager's Office staff has done some research related to community surveys, vendors, providers, question types, and have brought forward a recommendation this evening. So with that, I will turn the presentation over to Matt Havlak.
Yes, thank you, Eric. Good evening, Mayor and members of the Village Board. Community surveys serve as a mechanism to provide residents with the means to share valuable input with staff and elected officials in order to properly set community priorities and allocate resources effectively. Staff recently contacted multiple community service vendors, community survey vendors, to learn about methodology, survey questions, timelines, and more. Of the vendors that we contacted, Polco was identified as most favorable to meet the village's needs. Polco's National Community Survey instrument is designed to assess resident sentiment and satisfaction with key services of the village and programs. The NCS uses benchmark data from over 500 communities across the country and compares resident satisfaction levels and perceptions with those benchmark data. The NCS covers 10 key facets of community livability, including economy, mobility, community design, natural environment, safety, utilities, parks and recreation, health and wellness, education, arts and culture, and inclusivity and engagement. The methodology of administering a community survey includes surveying a representative sample of residents that will be invited to complete the survey to ensure a statistically significant response and results that usually consists of around 250 to 400 responses. Survey postcards and invitations will be mailed to households and will contain an introduction outlining the importance of the survey and instructions for completing it. This will be done, the survey can be completed via a secure URL. The survey is comprised of about 40 to 48 questions, and it'll take approximately 15 minutes to complete to avoid survey fatigue. In addition to the statistically significant data sample, POCO also recommends opening up the survey to any resident that would like to take it to keep this as a separate data set. These two data sets will be kept by POCO, and POCO will make the determination how these are best reported, either separately or together. Preparing, conducting, and reporting the survey is expected to take approximately 20 weeks. After data is collected and processed, POCO will provide a written report to the village. The cost for the survey to be conducted is $17,000. There's also an option if the village would like to add up to a half page of custom questions. So in the NCS, there's standard questions that are used benchmarked against other communities. So there is the option if we want to pay extra to add in our own questions. And funds are available in the budget for this year, and tonight staff requests Village Board direction on how to proceed with the community survey and agreement with POCO. Unfortunately, a POCO representative cannot be here tonight, but I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much for that presentation. I'll start to my left with Trustee Olson on comments or questions. Actually, I apologize. Let me ask for public comment. Anyone here for public comment in the boardroom? Seeing none, I'll start with Trustee Olson. Sorry about that.
Thank you. No questions, mostly a comment. I think surveys are important to gather data to know how best to deliver or not deliver required services. The only challenge that I've always seen on these whenever I've served on the boards is participation is always the challenge. Obviously, that's not on staff, but it's sometimes disappointing seeing the actual, you know, numbers that come back, and hopefully if we move forward with this, I'll be pleasantly surprised. That's it. Thanks.
Thank you. Trustee Mullen?
Thank you for bringing this to us. I'm sure Trustee Duffy would be here geeking out and jumping up and down. showing all the emotion right now. I really like and appreciate, too, that you gave us a side-by-side comparison of the three that you guys worked with and talked to. Thought that was really helpful because it actually helped me better think about the customized questions. You know, one of the options, you know, you could add whatever you wanted. They would work with us, which sounded really intriguing. But then it's really good to hear, like, the idea that, you know, the more we insert, you know, the longer it is. And we may be kind of diving down the wrong rabbit hole also. So I do like that it's a baseline against a lot of other communities. All of that is really, really beneficial to us. Since some of the areas I think kind of touch upon some of our other governmental partners, other bodies, would we be sharing the data also with like Park District and, you know, the other bodies in Lisle that we would benefit?
I think the report and the survey's results would be public.
Okay.
So most certainly we'd share those and they'd be available via their results report as they would to the general public as well.
Okay, cool. And then what kind of response rate, to Trustee Olson's point, do we need to have it be like a valid response? Like what are we hoping for?
Yeah, so when we asked Polco that question, they said that a village our size, they'll send out approximately 3,000 surveys as to a random sample within the village, and they'll expect around 400 to 500 responses within that, and
okay,
that would be deemed statistically significant to them.
Okay. Hopefully that's doable. That's good. And then are we going to supplement any of the outreach once it goes broadly to, you know, to all residents?
Yeah, so this sample size to 3,000 households would be sent out first, and then approximately 8 weeks later, we let them take the survey, and then we would post on the village website, all of our social media channels, other communication methods, upcoming village newsletter and everything, just to get that out there.
Awesome. Sounds great. Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. Trustee Greco?
I'm also appreciative of this. I remember when we talked about this initially, and how important it is that, you know, we respond to the general public. There's a hierarchy here. Not everybody can make a village board meeting, but they can have their input in how our village is administered and what they'd like to see. And this is one way of being able to provide kind of a what scope of services are important, where should we be focusing our attention. And I appreciate you putting this together. I noticed there are three compare and contrast. Are you just representing the POCO NRC, or is there going to be other presentations after this? Or
no, myself and Joe, we vetted the three companies that we spoke to, and we thought that POCO provided the best proposal and needs for the village.
Okay, and I noticed like on the second two, like ETC and Miami University, they kind of have a set number of surveys that would be incorporated. How many would be incorporated with the POCO NRC? I don't see a number. Is that just basically everyone we have an email for, or how would that work?
No, so they pick a sample of the data, so or of the population. So within Lisle's 24,000 plus residents, they put all the addresses and they pick it's a random sample that's generated to about 3,000 they'll start with, the residents, addresses, households that they'll send out. They'll receive that postcard with the link on it, and then when they respond to the survey online, they're required to put their name and their address in, and then that's validated against voter records that are public and that match that address to make sure that it's secure.
That makes total sense. I appreciate your clarification on that. Nope, that's all I had. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Trustee Lesniak?
When was the last time a survey like this has been done?
None to my knowledge.
I don't think we've done, I mean, that I'm aware of. I've been here 15 years. I don't think we've done a community-wide survey. We did do some outreach related to our strategic planning effort, but it wasn't as scientific as this method that's being proposed this evening.
So think I read that it's recommended that for best practices that a municipality completes a survey like this every 3 to 4 years.
Correct.
What would we do with the findings? Rather, instead of just patting ourselves on the back and saying, we feel pretty good about ourselves for having done a survey, we did our community engagement, we checked a box, what will we actually do with the data?
Well, a number of the questions are, you know, will be included as part of our performance management for the village through our strategic plan. So a number of these questions that are being proposed are directly tied to outcome metrics that the village board had approved. So again, this would be part of our reporting as well. I would assume too there would be some interest in utilizing this information as it relates to budget priorities and things of that nature. But primarily, the use would be as it relates to our strategic plan and those performance tracking as we look at that and where we see kind of our current baseline score, and then look when the survey was done again to see where that movement was.
And I think the end reporting is what's useful too, because it'll give you like a pie chart of, okay, so many people said this, or so many people felt this way, and so many people felt this way about it.
And
so
that brings me to my other concern is, these guys are the experts, so I'm assuming they've factored in the who responds, because usually when we do stuff like this, we get very low response rate. And of those responses, are they majority the psychology of it, where majority of people who fill out surveys tend to like to complain, or is it, it's such a scientific sampling and methodology that they will get people that are wanting to help rather than just air out. And again, it's perceptions, so I'm concerned with a lot of those questions. It's perceptions and subjectivity, and what do we do with perceptions and subjectivity and feelings when developing policy based on that? I lost my track of my line of thought with that.
I think I see where you're going. You're like, how you pose the question, you can make it like a loaded question, depending on how you phrase it.
I guess I'd like to see more objective data used. One of the questions was, how safe do you feel in the community? Whereas I would like to look at things like, what's the call rate within Lisle? And what's a good call rate, a police call rate, in a community this size, so that we have that kind of data to look at and go off of, instead of relying solely on feelings. And I suppose that could also be mitigated with us coming up with custom questions. My other concern was, this is a lot of money for a survey, and so I want to make sure that if we spend that money on this survey, that it will be money well spent, so that we're actually utilizing the data and not just filing it away in the filing cabinet, saying that we did one of these things.
I think the hazard of any survey, especially a completely random survey, is you're going to get completely random answers.
And that's why I'm questioning, and not questioning that this particular company, or just, I'm wondering if just the nature of doing a survey like this in today's age for the price is kind of outdated.
I think that most surveys that I've been involved in, that I've taken or put forth, are grading on a scale. And it is exactly those subjective questions, which is perception. How safe do you feel on a scale of 1 to 5, 1 to 10, whatever? How do you feel about X? How do you feel about Y? How do you feel about this? And then those are all graded with the results. But for it to be truly random and not targeted to people most likely to respond or most likely to air their grievances or anything, there's a risk we take in taking on something like this and then saying, well, we really don't like those results. We really don't feel that they're consistent with what we hear on a daily basis from our own community. I think part of that vetting process, I heard a part of the presentation about the official survey followed up by an informal portion of a survey that the surveyor may choose to incorporate or release or not release. I think if something like that happens and there's a secondary part of it, it has to be released to the public. If we're spending public money and there's a result that the surveyor says, nah, we can't release that, the public needs to understand, here's what somebody officially said, here's something that somebody unofficially said. It has to all be out there. And that might help everybody gauge, the public, the board, everybody, to say, all right, here's what the postcard said, but when we open it up to everybody, here's what also came in, and then we can better gauge where the important truth lies, because we are in a position where we have to interpret subjective things. There is no hard and fast answer when it comes to surveys, so it is a challenge.
Because I'm for community engagement. That's for sure. Mm-hmm. I'm just thinking out loud. I want to make sure that we're looking at the best practical approach, and it will result in a good benefit where it will actually impact policies and in a way that's not weighing so heavily on feelings, especially if it's impacting performance management. So I've got.
All right, Trustee Sima.
Thank you. Lots of thoughts in my head now, based on what everybody else has said. But I think you assuaged my concern about the random sampling a bit when you talked about the 3,000 being generated out of the 24,000 addresses. One of my concerns is, you know, Lisle has very disparate neighborhoods, and I wanted to make sure we'd get an adequate sampling from all the different neighborhoods. And I think if you're using all 24,000, that should happen. And yes, there is a concern that it's going to skew towards the complainers. Those are the ones that are going to get it in the mail and say, heck yeah, I got stuff to say. But hopefully we get, you know, I think there is value in hearing what the complainers have to say as well. And, you know, I have been on, and to Mike's concern about getting people to participate, yeah, that's always a challenge. But some of the other boards and committees that I've served on, we've used both community engagement in terms of meetings held at buildings and getting the community to come versus doing surveys. And I do find value in both of those methods. And so I think this is definitely a good starting spot. You know, depending on the answers, we might decide to do further community engagement in another method. So I think it's a good way to start. I also think that, I have to look at my notes for a quick second. Oh, as to your point about, you know, yes, it's subjective, of course it is, but that's just one piece of the data. So if we get a number of residents that say, we don't feel safe, well, I think our next step would be to contact our own police department, get the data from them, see are they coming from particularly neighborhoods in Lisle, are there things that we can do in those neighborhoods to make people feel better? So I think this is just going to end up being one of the pieces of data that we look at, and that once we get the results, we'll mesh them from data that we get from staff, the police department, public works, whoever. So I think that I'm in support for sure. I like the idea. I was going to ask the question, if it's a random sampling, what do we do about everybody else that wants to participate? So I like the fact that we'll be opening it up online to all of Lisle to participate, which I know that will open the door to the complainers, as you said, but I think it's worth doing. It's a valuable exercise, especially if we've never done one. We have to give our community some opportunity to tell us what they think. How are we doing? So that's it.
Thank you. I have a couple of points to address. Village is a population of 24,500 people for rounding reasons, for rounding purposes. But that includes everybody from birth to centenarians, 100 years of age. Is there a target audience that we're restricting this result to? And I ask that because 3,000 postcards is not going to 24,000 residents at random. 3,000 postcards is going to 10,000 households. And is it just resident households, or is it including businesses as well?
It's 3,000 households, addresses mailed to, and then within that, the directions will say one respondent from each household that's over the 18 years of age, and it's just residential addresses that'll be mailed to.
And it's checked against the voter list, so that they have to be registered voters in order to count?
I can verify that with Polco, but I would believe so.
Okay, and so each household is limited to one respondent, even though they may have 3, 4, 5, 6 voters in the household?
Correct, yes.
So it takes on a little bit of a different result, perspective. I think that I covered the public results. I think we also have to keep in mind, and it was kind of touched on earlier, about combining this with other overlapping taxing bodies. I think it's important to remember that it'd be great to be able to save costs and combine it with another taxing body. Anything that we can do to capitalize on things like that. But we also have to keep in mind that we are the smallest of those Venn circles properties and residents in the Village of Lisle. Village of Lisle is 24,500 residents. The library and park district is 30,000 residents. The fire district is 65,000 residents, and Lisle Township is 90,000 residents. So I say that because it's quite often that I get outreach from Lisle Township residents who think that I'm the mayor of Lisle Township and want me to take action at the township level. Village of Lisle is the smallest of the taxing bodies, and I think the questions on the survey have to be relevant to the services that the village provides: streets, police protection, sewer, water. And just as a reminder, not every resident in the Village of Lisle is a sewer and water customer. I'm not myself. So we all have different needs, different perspectives. But it should be to the Village of Lisle only. But I'd also like to open it up to business, to represent businesses. They're taxpayers in the Village of Lisle as well, and should have some kind of a say in a survey, because otherwise we're only serving half of our tax base, if that, by limiting it to residents only.
Did you read the questions, though?
We could do some custom questions.
Right, but I mean, there's 5 pages that are very designed about living in this community.
Mm-hmm.
So it would have to be a different set of questions for business community.
But I'm saying that if we do a survey and we spend $17,000 and does not include the business community, I think we've done ourselves a great disservice, because we start setting policy towards residents only and not towards businesses, which may have a different perspective. And the questions we choose to put on the survey, which at this point do not include businesses, right? We could put questions on there that there's residents who are business owners, right? And they may have a say that differs if those questions are or aren't asked. So it's been said, it's an expensive survey. Are we truly getting what we need out of it versus just getting static that we end up disregarding after spending $17,000 to $19,000? So those are my points. Should we go around once again? Go ahead.
I wanted to clarify, you made some good points, and I wanted to clarify that I'm not dismissing at all the public's concerns that they may express on these surveys. I definitely think those are valid. My point was, those concerns don't do the residents or us any good help trying to help those residents if we don't get to the root cause behind those feelings. For example, it's been thrown out a few times that Lisle is hard to work with. That is a feeling. So if we can identify a plan to identify the root cause of why someone may feel that, or they feel it's great to work with, why do they feel that way? So doing a deeper dive, and like Trustee Sima said, if we are using this survey just by itself and we're done, I don't think it'll be a good use of $17,000.
So let me...
If we use the survey in conjunction with follow-up workshops and, again, that root cause analysis, that deep dive, other methods, then it gets to be more beneficial.
So let me expound on that statement and comment. I think the statement that the village is difficult to work with is purely 100% a political statement and has no truth in fact. And staff would actually, we had a petitioner here last week that said staff is remarkable to work with. I have a developer right now who's weighing their options between our community and another community and going, Lisle is quicker and more responsive. We've rewritten all of our zoning codes. We've rewritten all of our building codes, which has never been done. Lisle used to have a reputation of being difficult to work in because of unique building codes, because of outdated zoning codes. We've set the table for developers and the residents and anybody else. People may not like the results they received, but the process they go through is equal and easy to work with. We've done more remote. We've done more electronic application. So, yes, it's a political statement, and it does a disservice to
the
village and to staff.
Point of order, we're talking about the community survey. That was an example that it's a feeling. And
that was a feeling that it was a political statement.
So could we just stay on the survey, please?
But I think it's a very valid point in this discussion, because that has been a feeling from many in the past. I don't know in the how, you know, we'd have to do a survey. How many people may still feel that way. But again, and that's a general statement, and doing that deeper dive, if someone did say, make a statement like that, well, tell us more. The entire process you didn't like, or the entire process you did like, break that down for us, because the process is numerous steps. It's complex. So that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, and to that end, I don't know how a $17,000 survey will elicit that type of a response.
Could I continue unless Trustee Sima has any further comments?
Well, my further comments would just be that I don't think it was necessarily a political comment. I had received numerous comments from other people saying the same thing, that Lisle has a reputation of being hard to do business with, not necessarily staff, referring perhaps to the board, PZC, whatever it is. I'd love to get to the bottom of why people feel that so we can correct it. And this is one of the ways that you do that.
Trustee Greco?
Yeah, sometimes you got to pick at a scab to heal. And I agree. I think it was just meant as a comment in general. Again, it's the whole purpose of why we want to do a survey like this. You put it out there. It's a question that we could decide that we want to add. And then we can respond, is kind of what the mayor said, or maybe take action.
Thank you, Trustee Greco.
Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah, take action as needed to help maybe change that perception of that image. But talking about it is what we want to do. It's one of the reasons why we want to go out with a survey. To that end, I think the mayor makes a point about businesses. If there's 10,000 households and we're sending 3,000 flyers out, how much extra would it be for 1,000 businesses to send out 300 questionnaires, maybe tailored just to the businesses? And again, they could be random questions. Have you recently, gone through a permit application for something on your property? How was that process? How was, we could formulate something that would be, or the consultant might be able to tailor something.
And this would tie into the report from Village Manager Ertmode about the economic development program. Are they planning on doing their own survey with the businesses? If not, does it make sense to include the businesses in this particular survey? If they're already doing a business survey for their program, then maybe we don't need to include it here.
And to help justify the expense of what we're doing here, let's say it might be an extra, $4,000 to $5,000 to do something like this. Say we're spending, $20,000 to $25,000 on a report like this. What Manager Ertmode is is asking for is the use of a quarter employee to basically go out and conduct this survey. This isn't a full-time job for someone. This is what would be the equivalent of a third or a quarter employee if hired by the village to conduct the survey. I've done these surveys before, and I've tabulated these surveys before, and you're right. You're going to get people out there that want to complain. But doing it this way with a company that has experience and has, a long list of the questions that we couldn't think of that other municipalities may have thought of that can or cannot be added, it goes a long way to have somebody who's a professional doing that, really getting the best bang for the buck in putting something forward like this. So I would be in favor of, if we're going to do a survey like this, also to include the businesses as well.
Yeah, and I'll just add that the National Community Survey is strictly meant for, it's a resident satisfaction survey. That's what this is, the resident's time to speak, and it's focused on them only. I think if we were to ask Polco about including businesses, I think they would recommend separating them, just because it's a different set of questions and responses, and it might confuse residents if they're seeing business-related questions on the survey, but I mean we can clarify that with Polco as well.
Yeah, I would totally intend for, like, if you're sending to what you know is a business, they're not getting the residential survey like Trustee Mullen had alluded to. Some of those questions don't make sense. So if we were to tailor something different, maybe we do this as a separate consideration if that's what's needed, if that's the best way of getting it done, then I'm all for it. It doesn't have to be, the same mailing. It could be two different programs even. So that's all I have. Thank you.
Can staff address whether this survey is going to require any staff time, a quarter employee time, for the duration of the survey or anything like that? Is there dollars attached to staff time?
The most of the staff time is weighted toward the beginning of that timeline. So we'd work with Polco. We'd be giving them just writing the introduction on the postcard and everything, our logo and all that. Then from there, once it gets mailed out, Polco pretty much handles that. I mean, I would envision like Joe and myself that would field any questions that came in, or if there's, let's say, someone that doesn't have a computer, we could give them a written copy too. Just kind of the customer service side of it after the beginning of it.
Any estimate of what that time might involve?
I don't know.
Maybe a staff can put some thought together on what the expectation would be, devoting current staff time to participating in the survey as well, just so we have a true cost all out the door.
Sure.
And then, if we eliminate any business-related questions that business persons may might involve business persons, i.e. planning and zoning, developers, things like that, and it's strictly residential, water service, patching potholes, snow plowing, police service, things like that, it significantly pares down the scope of of what the survey might be.
Again, is that something that could be addressed through the economic development program that village manager Ertmode is going to be covering?
At this point, there was no intention of doing a formal targeted business survey in the program. If the board direction would like a business survey, we can come back with a business survey question and probably engage POLCO again to on the business side. But again, this evening in the contract and the scope of service that staff is proposing is a resident-only survey without custom questions that's based on the national community survey implemented by 500 other communities across the country.
And I can tell you, I'll let staff speak for themselves, but I can tell you that there are staff members, there are members of the board that do interact with businesses and come back and report. Been doing that since day one. I had a pulse on the village during COVID, status of businesses, still do today. But businesses hold a lot of their comments close to their vest as well. It's not uncommon that we go do a retention visit with a business only to find out 2 or 3 weeks later that their entire business has changed, but they had to keep it confidential during conversations with us. So the business community, some things they'll discuss, some things they won't discuss. It's tough to get answers out of them because businesses rely on confidentiality, and there's a lot of information they won't share. I saw a hand pointing towards Trustee Mullins, so I didn't know if you were looking for the floor.
Yeah. I was just saying a point of order. I think that we're going around. Trustee Mullin.
I was responding to a comment, but go ahead, Trustee Mullin. No.
If you want to finish responding, that's fine, but
yeah.
Trustee Greco finished.
Done.
Whenever you are done responding, I would like
so I'm calling on okay. You. We don't have a time limit. When the previous person gives up the floor, then I'll cede the floor to the next trustee. So go on ahead.
There's a couple things on the questions that are highlighted. Do those have any specific significance?
There's two on there, and I highlighted those because those are the two exact ones that are laid out in the village's 2022 to 2025 strategic plan.
Okay.
On overall safety in the community, and then customer interaction with village staff. Those are specifically laid out.
Okay.
And
they're
just showing that this survey does cover those.
And I very much appreciate what you said about there would have to be two different surveys between residential and business, that this is baseline against 500 other, you know, residential surveys. This is designed explicitly for residents, which is when we first asked, when the board approached staff and said, hey, we really want this, that was really what the focus was trying to engage our residents in, hear from them, because we haven't gotten a really strong way to get input other than the random thing that we hear. And we want to stop just kind of what we overhear or what people complain about, right? Understanding that those who respond may have a axe to grind, but hopefully there's also people who are like, ooh, this looks fun, and just respond anyway.
Yeah, and that's why there's two different data sets or data, because the one is for the scientific one is the first one, and the second one, like what you said, that'd be more inviting for people that want to go out of their way to take this survey that have something that's bothering them or something they want to say specifically for that.
Yeah.
And then POLCO basically mentioned that the data that is given back, it's kind of, you look at it like there's, if they benchmark where we are kind of with all the other communities, if there's one that's lower than a lot of communities, maybe that's when you look at and you explore and do a separate smaller survey. You're looking at that data more. If there's one that's higher, you look at what you're doing really well that's getting that high score. So.
Yeah. I also think that the results of this, especially as we re-survey in the future, helps us identify where we are, where improvements we are making are working, where they're effective, as well as will help guide us in our refresh of the strategic plan in a couple of years, that we'll see kind of where we are. We have a lot of better input from residents to help us form that plan for the next several years after that. So I think that really feeds into that as well. I completely agree with once we get the results. We can't predict what our next steps are right now, but that we may, we'll probably identify places we want to dive in deeper. And I completely agree with that piece of it. And for, in terms of doing a business survey, I like the idea of surveying businesses, but at the same time, it could be something less formal as well. Understanding that some businesses keep things close to the vest. George is out there developing relationships, doing a great job of that. So like, he could actually be the person to bring it to businesses and talk them through it and, you know, do it that way. I think he's talked to like everybody, so, which is lovely. So I'm totally in favor. I think this is a very wise investment of funds. So we know really well where we're performing, where we have gaps, where we need to improve, where we're doing really well, and where we can focus our resources, our time, and our effort across staff, within our board, everything. So I think this absolutely is important. That's all.
Okay, anyone else have any comments or questions? We started with Trustee Olson.
No. We started
Trustee Olson's next.
No.
We went this way. We went back that way again, so I think.
Okay. Trustee Olson, then.
Thank you. I have three items based on the discussion that went around. I'm in support. We've never had one, and to me, that's a key piece of information here. We've actually spent a lot of time talking about this, and to me, having never had one, all of the potential scenarios and concerns that there, you know, may be all valid. But if you've never had one, we have no data to go off of whatsoever. So for that point alone, I'm supportive. I want to, I guess, either make the statement, it's not necessarily a question, but I want to just clarify. This is a survey for residents, not voters. So registered voters, completely mutually exclusive. This is for residents. And we need that because residents, either through rent or through property taxes as a homeowner, they're ultimately the ones that are paying for the taxes. So voting has nothing to do with this. And then three, it's been touched on a little bit, so I don't want to spend too much time, but on the business survey or business retention, I think it's really important. And I don't want to, you know, take up too much time, additional time in this meeting, but to me, where that's, that feedback needs to be coming through is what Trustee Lesniak, I think, is requesting from staff in terms of what the economic development strategy maybe is. And for me, I want to know when we get to that. That's not for this discussion, but that the top 10 property taxpayers on a commercial basis and the top 10 sales tax generators in the village are having regular conversations with economic development, including the hotel taxpayers. We spent a lot of time talking about hotel motel tax and where those funds can and can't be spent, and I don't necessarily have a good feeling or pulse on what the hotel owners and operators think. And so it's a very valid point on wanting to get the feedback from businesses, and maybe ultimately a survey is the right way. I'm not suggesting that it's not, but what I can say is the relationships with our staff on the economic development side, it's going to be a lot more valuable to me than whatever a survey says. So I'm not dismissing, you know, a potential survey for that. I do think staff has pointed out why it needs to be separate if it wanted to be done. But knowing that, you know, we on relatively short notice recently have learned about soon to be losing a significant sales tax contributor to the village, I think it's relevant to bring this up now, but probably more relevant to discuss at a later meeting for what Trustee Lesniak said. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other board member comments?
My last comment would be that I like, since I haven't touched on the business piece of it, I do think it would be great to touch, have a conversation with our business owners. I think it's a great suggestion that we start with the economic director that we have on staff that's already starting to develop these relationships. We can decide maybe based on his investigation whether or not to do a formal survey, but I do think it's the best use of our resources to start with him.
And again, I wanted to clarify that I'm in favor of the survey, And I do think the perceptions of the residents are very important. If they're not so positive, or if they are positive, both are very important to gather. But it's very important to me that those perceptions are also followed up and looked at as to what is causing those perceptions. And because that's how we will improve anything that needs to be improved.
Nothing to add except transparency is good. And you kind of alluded to that before. If we get results in this, we need to be transparent with them as well. That's all. Thank you.
Nothing further.
Trustee Olson.
Nothing further.
So comment was made about changes in business, quick changes in business. Just want to report to the board that since I found out about one of these quick changes, I've had one conversation with an existing business that wants to grow, one conversation with a business that does not exist in Lisle, that is looking for a place in Lisle. And staff has had a conversation with somebody interested in that property. So things do happen quickly. Things do happen through the right avenues. The referrals are made in the right manners, and we move forward. And this board and others will potentially have some difficult decisions they have to make on where development in Lisle heads. And what the impact to Lisle ends up being. So a lot of good news, despite sometimes getting bad news. So with that, there's a lot of information here in this agenda item, a lot of different subtleties to it. I think we have a consensus to do a survey. I think we have some concerns for what the end result, or how the survey is administered, and what the limits are of it. But I think staff has direction to proceed with the survey, and then let staff come back to the board. I think if the board concurs, bring it back to the board and weigh it again with what, if it meets the board's expectations. Do we have concurrence on that?
Are you suggesting that in committee of the whole again, or into the board meeting?
No, I think committee of the whole. I don't know that we have it close enough to bring it for all out action.
I'm ready to move forward.
I'm fine as well.
Me too.
As am I.
Okay. Well, then we'll put it on a regular agenda then.
You want to see the survey questions as part of the regular agenda, or the contract with Polco? Because I think to move forward with the survey and agenda, I mean, these are the standard questions that are before the board of the national survey. Staff's not recommending at this time any customizable questions. This is our first time doing this. Staff would recommend we just move forward with the standard survey, and the questions are here. So, what am I bringing forward for consideration?
I would support bringing the contract with Polco with the standard questions.
Okay. Well, it's under my purchasing authority, so staff can, if I'm given direction, the okay now, I can sign the agreement and move it forward.
Do we have concurrence on that?
Yes.
Yep. Yes.
Okay.
So we'll move forward with the agreement and then move forward with the implementation of the survey.
Awesome.
Okay.
Is there any way to customize the component at all? Or?
Well, that's not what we agreed upon.
Nobody wants to customize any questions?
I think to the village manager's point, the first one, you're setting your baseline, it's a little bit too much. So let's set our baseline. Let's hit our microphone. There's like 4.5 pages. It's pretty substantial. It's very,
it's lengthy.
Extensive.
I don't know if we just wanted to put a twist on our own village. You know, we're talking about feelings before and things that might be unique to the village. I don't know if there might be something already in there that just basically says, is there any additional things that you want to say? Or is there space for something like that at all or no?
There is. We asked Polco about adding custom questions. They did not recommend it, especially for a first survey like this one. They recommended for the first one, just keep it simple and basic as possible, and then you can build off of that later.
Did you say there was a comments section, though?
There can be added one. Polco, they also did not recommend that. It'll be just a page of comments at the end. There's not much comparing or anything to that.
You really can't. You really can't composite that data from a general statement that's out there.
There's no analysis to be done.
Yeah, there's no analysis.
It can be done if
the village. No, I'm in favor of the baseline questions. We could do that first, obviously. I'm just excited that we're finally doing one, which is, it's always good to hear back from your constituency. So I'm in favor.
Okay, so staff's got direction. Okay, we'll move on to our last item on the agenda, donation contribution policy. Deputy Village Manager, CFO Mitchell, would you please provide an overview of this proposed policy?
Good evening, Mayor and members of the board. The village receives donations and contributions in monetary or property form from private citizens, business groups, or other organizations throughout the fiscal year. Donors often designate how the donations can be used by the village. In order to document the process for the acceptance and use of donations, staff recommends that a donation and contribution policy be established. The Government Finance Officers Association recommends that every government document its financial policies and procedures. Establishing a policy will ensure the proper accounting and use of donated funds and property, while also providing the framework for accountability and transparency. A summary of the proposed policy includes the following: donations of monetary or property valued at $5,000 or less, not including real estate regardless of value, may be accepted by the village manager on behalf of the village without village board approval. Donations of monetary or property valued at greater than $5,000 or real estate regardless of value shall be presented to the village board for acceptance. A budget amendment must be approved by the village board prior to spending a donation or contribution of $5,000 or more. Donations shall not be accepted by the village if such donation or contribution is for the personal benefit of an employee, appointed, or elected official. Donations will not be accepted by any party, including a group, organization, company, or person, or any individual belonging to a group or organization or company with a pending application or matter before any village boards or commissions. Staff requests village board direction on preparation of a resolution adopting the proposed donation and contribution policy. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that presentation. What I'd like to do is start out just by asking if anybody has any differences to what's presented here, or maybe we can come to a quick conclusion.
Yeah, I support the policy in general. My only question was whether we would want to add to it a component regarding political groups, PACs, anything like that. Like, also, I agree with the provision to not accept anything from anyone with a pending matter. Would we also want to consider adding not for any political purposes or from any political groups? Just a thought.
For political purposes?
Or for political purposes or from any political affiliations, like any PACs, anything of that nature. Anybody have any thoughts on that?
I think that's good.
Would you have to define at what point a group is considered a political group?
That's kind of where I was headed.
I think if they're registered as a political organization or a PAC, that would be pretty clear, I hope.
Wouldn't it be a repeat of what state statute may already be indicating on it? I don't know if it's redundant or not. I mean, I'm all in favor of the language. I'm just saying, is it maybe asking the village attorney, is that something that may already be covered by state statute?
I mean, in section 2.1, we it says in there that it's a donation from somebody who expects nothing in return. So legally, I don't know there'd be a problem with the village, you know, a corporate entity of the village receiving a donation from a political group. Now, you could certainly have a policy that says you don't do that. But legally, I don't see an issue with it.
Would you include politicians directly, or elected officials or appointed officials individually?
Actually, can I jump in?
Sure.
Yeah, I mean, somebody said something about the definition of PAC and how it's problematic. And I think that you could really create a problem for yourself. For instance, you know, you can think of any number of organizations that have a political arm and, a fundraising arm or a benevolent arm. And I think you'd probably create a difficult situation.
Have we had a lot of gifts from those types of organizations in the past?
Not within the last few years.
I'd like to clarify.
Well, from political action groups.
How about politicians or anybody that's an elected official?
We have had a donation of equipment from an elected official within the last year.
Was that personal property of an elected official, or was it coming through their political action committee?
It was not personal property of the elected official. It was through their employment.
I'm not sure if I'm up, but I'm going to ask a question anyway. Is this a policy looking for, I won't say a problem, but how often has this come up in the last 5 years, 10 years?
Well, we have regular donations to the police department, monetary donations, and most times they're designated for something specific, but not often. But we have seen an increase in donations to the police department, so we wanted to document something. We did have the one donation of equipment in the last few years. But monetary donations, I'd say we have, let's say, 4 or 5 per year.
And thank you for, I guess, highlighting what one of my next questions would be. The dollar thresholds I'm comfortable with, and in particular, because it somewhat leading what my question is on the having in my family a fundraising background and some nonprofit service, donations with significant restrictions, whether it be grants, et cetera, can be problematic. And so how often on those is it that it's designated that this is a monetary donation and it's for general police use? I guess what I'm getting at is, do sometimes donations become problematic in terms of implementation, staff time, of making sure that they're being applied appropriately? I know that's a little bit different. You're asking for a policy to act as a governor for the dollar threshold. I'm just asking about the accepting of donations in general. How much extra work is having to put in and accepting and administering those donations?
I mean, there's the tracking of the donations, especially for the designated ones, to verify that we're spending it on what the donor had asked us to. I don't think we're talking about a lot of staff time, but there is time associated with doing that.
Okay, thank you. So in terms of the specific question that was put to the board, I don't have anything specific on the dollar thresholds. On the, political question, I'll let that go around the dais a little bit more, but in terms of what's outlined here, I don't have any issues with what's written in terms of additional additions that may need, or amendments that may need to be added. I'm interested to hear what others think.
I have a question. You mentioned that a lot of these are donations to the police department. I know the police department, among other public safety agencies, often get donations of excess foods after events and things like that. Would this policy prohibit that as it relates to benefiting an individual or anything?
This is specifically for monetary or property donations. I mean, I would consider a food donation that's probably insignificant and not related to this policy.
De minimis?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. We'll continue around Trustee Greco?
I have no additional language to add to it. I'd be in favor of adopting it as is.
Well, I think that based on the fact that, I'm assuming everybody else had their say correctly, or do you want to add anything?
Trustee Mullins' turn.
I was just going to say thank you for identifying a need, a gap in policies, and, you know, bringing this forward to us. If Trustee Olson is cool from a financial perspective, you're more the guru than I am on that. It all seems straightforward to me. I think it's interesting to talk about the political piece of it, though, because I think we've already talked tonight about political messaging and accusations that there's some sort of political motivation behind what people say. So while I am happy that we have in here, which I think is similarly aligned to state law and ethics codes of, you know, can't be for the benefit of an elected official or anything like that, I don't know if PACs, if political organizations, if elected officials should be donating, because you absolutely can be looking to curry favor when you do that. I think it's worth a discussion of adding in language related to who is donating. So.
Sorry, I don't want to interrupt.
No, yeah. I'm good.
That's also my concern. You know, this is a nonpartisan board, or supposed to be a nonpartisan board, and I'm always concerned about the appearance of impropriety and making sure we appear above board in all things that we do. You know, and just to use two examples from opposite ends of the spectrum, you know, we were talking about green initiatives last night. I'm sure some of our constituents would be pretty unhappy if we accepted a donation from, say, Greenpeace or Sierra Club. And on the other side of the political spectrum, some people might be unhappy if we accepted a donation from something like the NRA. So, and, you know, that's kind of where my thought process is. I think we could perhaps consider adopting the language as proposed, because I don't think any of us have any problems with the language as is. But considering, then we could also, you know, investigate adding additional language to address political organizations at some point.
Sorry, Trustee Mullen. I mean, the only thing that I'd add, and that's the reason why the dollar threshold was important to me, is that I do understand Trustee Simon's point, and I probably use this similar example that, you know, it would be very easy. You could pick different organizations, whether it be Planned Parenthood or pick whatever from whatever side. It would be very easy to have a significant portion of our residents be unhappy. Probably a third, a third, and a third in this country in terms of political party affiliation. So that being said, for me, with the threshold being, you know, less than $5,000, I guess if, you know, people could get upset if it fell below that threshold and ultimately it was accepted. But anything over that threshold, it would come before this board to have that discussion, not this board, but the board in general and whoever was sitting here at that time. So I understand the concerns on the political spectrum, but for me, because the dollar threshold that staff has established is fairly low in terms of where it needs to come in front of the village board, I'm okay with it as drafted, because then hopefully we won't be put in that position. But, you know, maybe it would be a really, really difficult position if the NRA or Planned Parenthood for some reason decided they wanted to donate a significant amount of money to the village. Well, hopefully that day doesn't come, and, you know, we're playing out scenarios that probably aren't all that realistic anyway. So I'm fine as drafted. Thank you.
I think we have consensus for fine as drafted. Village Manager Ertmo, is that enough direction for
it
you
is.
To proceed?
Thank you. Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much. We will move on to officials and staff reports. I'll start with Trustee Olson. Anything to add?
Nothing for me, thank you.
Trustee Mullen?
Nothing else.
Trustee Greco?
Not what I said earlier, we're good.
Trustee Lesniak?
Nothing.
And Trustee Sima?
Nothing.
All right, I alluded earlier that I would expound on something. Earlier, a solicitation permit was brought up. I just want to let everybody know that I had an experience with a solicitor coming knocking on my door, actually met him in the driveway. He did have a permit. I believe it was issued through the new village process through iCompass, OpenGov. And so the process worked exactly as it was intended to work. The process is simple to register for solicitors, and I witnessed it firsthand myself, so I have that report to file to the board. With that, Clerk Rao, any report?
Nothing, thanks.
Any further village comments, village staff comments?
Nothing further, Mayor, thank you.
May I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Clerk Rao, please call the roll.
Trustee Olson.
Aye.
Trustee Greco. Trustee Lesniak.
Aye.
Trustee Mullen.
Aye.
Trustee Sima.
Aye.
Mayor Pisak.
Aye, and we are adjourned for this evening. Thank you all.